See, Teddy's going to start you guys off today. We're going to talk about the differences between boxing and kickboxing and some of the advantages and disadvantages of both modalities. So, Teddy, do you go?
All right. Hello, everybody. So, we're just going to start with talking about some boxing and kickboxing strengths and weaknesses. Okay, so right off the bat, of course, is the stance, right, and also where your hands are. So, a lot of times in kickboxing, you'll see the hands are a little further out, but it's more of a square stance, right? If you're talking about Muay Thai. If you're talking about pure boxing, you'll see a more linear stance, but of course, the weight is more, right, pinned to the ground. And yes, you're using footwork, but you're actually open for the leg kick, which is kind of dangerous, right? So it's harder to block or check the kick or move out of the way because you're only focusing on throwing the punches, right? So obviously, you have to be able to work a little bit of both your hands and your kicks, right? And in JKB, you obviously work both, and plus that, you work grappling, you work the weapon, different types of elements, not just punching and kicking. But if we're just talking about punching by itself, right? I'll start off just throwing a basic jab, right? So you get into a linear stance, you got your back foot up, right, you're throwing a jab. Now, a lot of times in boxing, when they throw the jab, right, most of the time they just step in, right, they throw it snappy and quick, which is good. Snappy and quick, and they step in with their lead leg. And obviously, it's very snappy, very quick. If they're not used to the leg kick, it could be a problem, right? So if I snap it out and I've never been kicked before, I'm putting myself in a position.
Does it tickle, Superintendent, or does it really hurt?
It obviously really hurts, because if it tickled, all the boxers would be able to step in, hit the kickboxer with no problem. But if you see in history, right, that really didn't happen much. Go watch it yourself, look it up. Go to YouTube, go to the archives, you see old fights. Boxing versus kickboxing. The boxer steps in, he tries to throw his punches, and he's getting kicked and chopped like a tree. He's never seen the kicks before, right? So it becomes a problem. So again, I step in for that jab, I'm planting on that lead leg, and bang, I walk right into that leg kick. And that leg kick, right, let's say a Thai fighter is throwing it, a Thai kickboxer, they're throwing it 2 inches above the knee on the peroneal nerve. If you just press hard on that nerve, you'll feel how much it hurts. Imagine someone throwing a full power hook kick or round kick to your leg with their shin, trying to chop your leg up. Right? If you never felt it before, it causes a lot of pain and a lot of damage, right? Eventually, after 3 or 4 hard kicks, right, sometimes even less than that, you start limping. Right? Now you're worried about doing anything because you don't want to commit to a punch. Once you put weight on, you get kicked again. Right, so you start backing up and start limping. It messes with your game, right? And even getting kicked inside the thigh, right? Does a lot of damage. Here it's even more sensitive, right? Again, you just take your thumb and press on these nerves here. Outside the thigh, inside the thigh. And just feel it for yourself. One good leg kick, right? It knocks the bouncer off balance, obviously, and it does damage, and it messes with their mind. Right? If you've never been there, it's going to throw you off. So that's definitely a weakness that a boxer would have going up against a kickboxer, right? One of the strengths that a boxer would have would be more in that range where you're pretty much just throwing mostly punches, and you can fire off the punches and step in where the person can't really leg kick you, right? You step in far enough, fire off your shots, and then you get out. But again, most of the time to do that, you have to be aware of the leg kick and know how to defend against it. If you never defended against it, then it's not gonna really work for you, right? So let's talk about the rear hand, right? The cross, bang. Again, if I throw a cross, even if I'm moving with footwork, it's very alive and active, but I can roll out with it. Now again, if I've never been kicked to the head before, that's another problem, right? I can be here, bottom weave. I can go a little lower if I want. Now there's knees involved, right? I don't want to go too low. Obviously the knee's going to come up to the chin. So I have to shorten the movements, right? Now the bottom weave has to be shorter. If I go all the way, I can get kicked easier to the head and knee, grab. So things change with the person you're fighting, okay? So another good tool that a boxer has, obviously those hooks, those uppercuts, just with their hands, right? Powerful punches, crisp shots, uncrisp shots, obviously knowing where to place their punches, the timing, very strong in that area. But let's say the kickboxer starts throwing side kicks, right? Basic side kick. So now the side kick usually will go, if you're talking about sport, it's usually gonna go to the body, right? It's gonna go to the belly, solar plexus, liver. So that poses another threat. If I don't know how to defend that kick, I'm running right into it, right? I could throw a great jab cross hook. That side kick's coming, man, it's a longer weapon than my hands, and I'm gonna run right into it. So that poses another threat. So obviously, as a martial artist, as a JKD practitioner, you have to be able to look at different styles, boxing, kickboxing, find the strengths and the weaknesses, and then try to see where it fits in to your art, right? To your personal style, and see what you can pick up from it, right? For me, I like the jab in boxing. It's very crisp, it's very snappy, very quick. I like the side kicks, right? That some of the American kickboxers have. I like the round kick that the Thais have. But again, I modify it. I don't just copy the exact style. I look at what's good, I modify it to fit into my art, which is Jeet Kune Do, right? So I have to shorten the movements to be able to fit it into my art. I don't wanna throw a traditional Muay Thai roundhouse kick where I have to load up, and also where I have to be in a different stance. I wanna be able to fight out of my stance, right? I'm not saying that the Muay Thai stance is wrong, or the boxing stance is wrong, or any stance is wrong. It has its time and place. But for me personally, I like to have my Bajon stance, right? And you can know to call the Bajon stance, big toe and heel, you've got your back heel up, your knees are slightly bent, and you're more mobile, working your in and out footwork, sliding, pushing, shuffling, curving, and you're blending in, obviously, different elements from, let's say, boxing or kickboxing. But again, you're not copying it to the exact, right? You're putting it into your personal style and saying, okay, I'm gonna modify it a little bit. I might modify the jab a little, maybe slide out. I don't have to plant my leg and get it chopped off right with a round kick, etc. So modifying, fighting smart, and being able to adapt, right? That's the ultimate in Jeet Kune Do. What did Bruce Lee talk about? Being able to adapt to any fighter, to any stylist, to any martial artist that you're going up against, right? You have to be able to get to that level. And it takes time, it takes effort, it takes training, it takes thinking, right? You have to put it all together and really study and find out for yourself, right? Because I can sit here all day and tell you what to do and how to fight a certain martial artist or a certain practitioner, but you'll never get it unless you try it and see for yourself. Like, let's say you spar in the martial arts school and then, okay, you see, oh, this doesn't work for me. Let me try something else, right? And then you figure out, okay, this works for me better, so I'll use this. So again, talking about sometimes discarding what is useless for you, right? And adding what is essentially your own that works for you, right? Oh, let me see if there's a comment.
If the opponent trapped my feet after a head kick, which technique do you recommend? If the opponent trapped my feet. Okay, so you're saying, Jose, that
if your opponent caught your kick, right? I think that's what basically you're saying.
If you kick your opponent to the head and they caught your kick, right? Which technique do you recommend?
Okay, usually if you throw a head kick, you have to, first of all, time it really well, and you don't want to just throw it because you like throwing it. If you're fighting a certain practitioner, a certain fighter that is good at grabbing those kicks, or right, they know how to block it, they know how to catch it, you obviously, first of all, have to time it really well and set it up where obviously they can't grab your leg. Now, if they start grabbing your leg, you have certain options. You can start hitting right away, right? And then obviously get your leg back, slide out, etc. Sometimes, if you're desperate, right, the guy has your leg, he's trying to throw you, but you have to do this very fast. Let's say that they caught your kick, for instance, right? They caught your kick, it's a body kick, let's say, right? Maybe you went to the head and somehow they wrapped around and they caught it, right? You went towards the head, bang, they stepped out and they caught your kick, right? So now you're on one leg and you're fighting from here. If the person is running you down or trying to pull you back, sometimes, but again, it has to be done explosively and quick, you turn your back real fast, boom, and you whip it out, right? So from here, bam, you whip your leg out and you turn around real quick. Again, a little risky, but it gets you out and it surprises your opponent and they lose that grip and you're back up, right? Obviously, another option, you grab the head, bam. If you control the head, you control your body, right? So if you can get some sort of control, again, you start hitting, grab the head and bang, right? Get that clinch, elbows in, get your hips back. You can push out from there, start throwing knees, your decision from there, right? So it gets tricky when someone starts catching those kicks. That's why you gotta time it and set it up really well. Okay, so I hope that answers your question. Okay, those are definitely some options you can try. But again, let's say you're good on the inside with your punches, right? Boxing. Great. Now you're fighting more hybrid, right? You're fighting mixed martial arts, you're sparring, whatever it is.
You're welcome. That's it.
How can you put it into your personal style now? I'm a great boxer, let's say, right? I'm great on the inside. I can work the shoulder roll, bump the opponent, work those uppercuts, those hooks. I get them on the ropes. I start firing fast, snappy shots. That's awesome. But now if you're, let's say, sparring in a more mixed element where there's takedowns, there's kicks, that's a whole different playing field. So now I have to think about, okay, I've never seen these kicks before. I've never seen these takedowns before. Obviously, I'm going to get hit with them in the beginning. I have to learn what they're doing and adapt, right? Otherwise, you're not going to grow. Right? If you're just doing boxing, yes, you'll be fine in that sport, right? Because it has its rules and its regulations, and you're not allowed to do certain things. But realistically, again, if you're talking about street fighting, self-defense, mixed martial arts, overall martial arts, right? It's limited. And I'm not saying that it's bad or it's wrong. I love boxing. I love kickboxing as well. But again, it's limited because the totality is not there, right? So that's another thing about Jeet Kune Do. We talk about totality, right? Bruce Lee, if you read his books, if you read his notes, he talked about all of these things, finding the strengths, the weaknesses, trying to find a totality within what you're doing, not just limiting yourself to only punches, only kicks, only grappling. Right? How are you gonna put it all together and make it better? Okay. So again, obviously the stance has its strengths and weaknesses. It definitely has strengths, right? And obviously in the Thai stance, right? Let's talk about the Thai stance for instance. I love Muay Thai, I love kickboxing, but again, it has its limitations, right? Sifu James explained it yesterday as well. You're in a square stance. The takedown is going to be easier for the grappler, right? Your feet are closer. It's going to be hard to sprawl and get out, right? Your base is not really there. Why? Because in that sport, when you're fighting in that sport, you're fighting in the ring, there's certain rules. You're not allowed to grab the guy below the hips and throw him to the ground. So they don't have to worry about a takedown. They're worrying about kicks, right? So a lot of times they're going to fight in that mid-range, check the kicks, and just start throwing bombs, elbows, knees, shin kicks, clinching. Now the grappling's allowed from the hips up in Muay Thai, right? You could grab around the waist and dump the person, grab the head, underhooks. But again, the limitation is where you cannot grab below the hips. So that's why they can get away with standing here, right? And just worrying about checking those kicks and throwing right back. Right? So knowing why a certain system has these rules, why do they use it? And one martial artist told me years ago, and I agree with them, every art is good for what it was created for. Right? Every martial art is good for what it was created for. Right? Certain styles, the person, let's say whoever made it back then, maybe they were smaller, maybe they were fighting in condensed areas. So again, that style is going to be different than someone who grew up maybe grappling or wrestling in the sand. Right? So environment plays a role too. So all these things have to be thought about when you're talking about what works, what doesn't work, what's more effective. And another good quote by Bruce Lee, if you want to talk more about the philosophy, right? He basically said, and these are not the exact words, but this is pretty much what he meant. Picking and choosing styles becomes a disease, right? Oh, this is the best style. I don't care what anyone says. No, this is the best style, right? And that's where the martial artists got into dispute from back then. And then obviously along the way, mixed martial arts came, and then they saw that, oh wow, this guy Bruce Lee knew what he was talking about. They're like, oh wow, we don't have to only grapple. We don't have to only kickbox. We don't have to stay in the confinements of our style. We can go outside of that. And this guy Bruce was a genius. He saw that before all these people. He's like, no, the martial arts are wrong. They've been doing it wrong for thousands of years. And he figured it out. He goes, okay, we need totality, right? We need truth, we need totality. We need to be able to figure out what's the best for that individual, right? Obviously, you have a structure in Bruce's art, right? You have the stance, the footwork, etc. Right? And again, that's based on biomechanics, right? So he didn't look at tradition. He looked at science when he was creating his art, right? His personal style. And then he finally went beyond that and he goes, okay, what's the best way I can throw a punch? What's the best way I can throw a kick? So this guy did his research, thorough research, and came up with obviously good results. Right? He became, I mean, it speaks for itself, just watching him move alone, even if he didn't fight anyone, whatever. I mean, back then they didn't have mixed martial arts fights. They didn't have, the kickboxing came around in the 80s, the American kickboxers. So it wasn't as popular. There was karate tournaments, and he saw the flaws in the karate tournaments, right? Obviously it was more point fighting, there was no contact. So he saw this in the 70s, right? And he pretty much foresaw what it was going to become. Right? So very, very smart, very intelligent. And of course, in my opinion, the greatest martial artist of all time. Right? So again, just even going beyond boxing and kickboxing, right? Finding the strengths, finding the weaknesses, studying, reading about it, and even just watching. If you go on YouTube and just watch old fights, right? Sometimes you can watch boxing, right? In boxing alone, right? Frazier versus Ali, great. But then you can find other fights where it's a boxer versus a kickboxer, or a boxer versus a wrestler. They're out there. If you look, You'll find those fights, and then you can study it for yourself, and you're like, oh, wow, that makes more sense. I understand why the wrestler has this stance. He just wants to grab and get the fight to the ground, get it over with. Right? And obviously, the boxer just wants to throw punches and try to get the knockout. Right? But again, think about limitations, think about totality, and think about adapting. How can you adapt any sort of style and make it work for you, right? Looking at the elements that make it good, right? So again, it goes back to studying, reading, training, and putting it all together, okay? All right, I'll step off for now. I'll see everyone later.
All right, so student study actually coincidentally left it off with what I was gonna talk about, which is putting it all together. See, a guy like Steve Lutetti's done a plethora of martial arts. He boxed, did kickbox, wrestled, did Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu as well. And the best of the best, I think Steve Lutetti would agree, and most good instructors would agree, can put it all together and blend it. So I'm gonna give some kind of funky examples first. Steve Lutetti went through one of these in a few videos back. Maybe some of you saw it, maybe some of you didn't. And we're gonna blend the classic boxing technique, which is the shoulder roll with a side kick, right? So, you know, I'm in there with the guy, I rock back on that shoulder, and I just lift and fire that lead side kick. It can go to the leg, or it can go to the belly, the liver, the solar plex, whatever the case may be, right? So when I rock back, the weight's on my back leg makes me lifting this leg super easy, right? So imagine I'm in there with the guy, he's thinking we're boxing, I catch, I roll bang. As I'm rolling, I fire this shot. So it's like, I'm rocking back and firing all in one motion. I don't rock back, wait, fire. I could, but it would be slower. Right there, right to the lead knee, right to the body if I need to, right? So shoulder roll, the side kick. Now, let's stick with the defense as it relates to the legs. So sometimes you break your kickboxing stance. I'll show you a little trick. You'll be in like a bladed, kind of low stance. And when the punch comes, you slip. Right, so you actually do a full, like almost Dominic Cruz style slip. And this way you can spring from this lower, almost seemingly boxing stance, which allows you to push off the back foot to throw your back leg kick, your round kick off the back leg, right? So we're here, I'm posturing boxing style, and look, when you do it, put your head down. Put your head down, put your rear shoulder high, because if it hits you and it bounces off your forehead, it doesn't hurt as much as if it hits you square in the face. Let's do it the other way.
Can you see me? I think so.
Yes.
So I'm here, low stance. Now watch. The second my weight loads on the right leg, I can step across. And you know, a lot of the MMA guys are talking about this calf kick. I've been playing with this. So if he's got his left lead and I got my right lead, I'm poking him and his shove comes up, I just hide behind the shoulders. Slippery defense. I'm here, I'm moving, and it's hard. It's a hard horizontal shin to the leg. So today we're not gonna talk about wrestling. We're gonna probably do wrestling next week versus striking, striking versus wrestling, wrestling versus striking. But today, boxing versus kickboxing. And now we're trying to combine it in a way that makes sense for kind of everyone, right? So let's go off of an angle now. I'm here, I'm on the inside. I shoot an uppercut with an angle. Low kick, right behind it, real simple. Low kick, right behind it. Other way. Low kick, right behind it. So if he's square like this, and you take the angle, and that shin goes right across the top of the thighs, oh yeah, it hurts like hell. So look, angle. Low kick. You can get it left lead, fire another one if you need to. And remember that loose spaghetti leg action does not feel good. Literally does not feel good. So, I'll give you a tip, because we've been kind of favoring the kickboxer, because obviously we favor totality. But let's say you're watching, You're a student, you're an incoming student, might be a student one day, maybe live in Wisconsin, whatever. Bottom line is you may have a boxing background. So, a couple of skills you need to deal with a kickboxer. Little trick, if you've never checked a kick, don't try. But, let's say that round kick comes your best bet, turning the knee out, taking one to fire your hardest left hand. So you're taking one to give one, but you're bracing your leg the right way. So I see that round kick coming, I turn my knee out, and I just bash as hard as I can. Same thing, look, the kick comes to the inside leg, turn your knee in, cross hook. Old school bastard style. Now this is for the boxer versus the kickboxer for dummies, the cliff notes, the fast version where like you're not learning the footwork, you're not learning to check the kick. This is, you walk outside right now, you're a boxer, someone kicks your leg, what do? Right? So you turn that thing inwards and you unload. Better options, use your footwork. Shuffling, don't let those legs get chopped. Don't let your head up, not today, right? Just walking off the slab, right? So, you know, another thing, if you're a boxer, if a round kick comes to your body, like a roundhouse kick, big wide circle, catch the kick. Big wide circle, and lateral. You know how like in boxing, lateral footwork, same thing. Lateral footwork, straight kick comes to the belly, scoop it, scoop it, scoop it, scoop it. So now let's get back to putting it all together, right? Now, I touch a low kick, right? So look at my boxing goes off for this one. I touch a low kick, and I want to follow up with my hands now. So I started with the legs. I was good enough to score on one. And then, basically, what do I do with my hands to follow? I'll give you a couple of easy examples, some tricky ones. We're here kickboxing style, right? So let's put some stuff together. I'm here, I post. Just come in with a basic cross up. Jab, jab, post on the cross. And just continue your combination punching. We could add motion to this by a counterman, we could do a lot of things, but it's real basic. Jab, post with the cross. Low kick with my hand in the leg, shoot the cross, shoot the hook, and again, we can put footwork in there if we wanted to. One, two, post this way, low kick, fire the hook on the way out. It's like a sneaky little trick. So if I fire like a bad hook, fire that hook. Guys get caught with stuff like that all the time. They get hit, and then they get hit with the next shot. Like, guy fires a front kick, and he fires the cross hook on the land. So this is you just adding good hands with good legs, good boxing with good kickboxing, whatever you want to call it. So look, bang, I fire that low kick, I step off. So I fire, left leg lands, and I throw a rear straight off of my rear leg front kick. Rear front foot, bang, and then I angle off. I just did this. With front kick, and I just added it all together. So we're going to kickboxing to boxing. I fire, bang. I watch when this lands, right there. Right over the top, start trying to put people out. Putting the angles in with your boxing and kickboxing is a very, very, very smart way to do things if you ask me. Now, I'll show you another cool one. Sometimes you're here, you kind of like gave a little ABD, and then you hit the low kick anyway. Like, so he's here, whoop, and you're baiting him. You're like, you're moving, yeah, spinning back kicks, you can tennis style, all that crazy stuff. So that definitely works. Now, I'll show you. See, the kickboxers do something called a long guard. They do this, they reach with one, and this guard is here, and it's good because you can, from this position, elbow and smash. Problem is in boxing, sometimes the guys will sneak the fast punches down to your liver when you do this long guard. Now I'm gonna give you a trick. When you long guard, cross pattern. So look at my glove. It goes across. So if it's here, I'm not going to go to this side. I'm going to go to that side. So that if I'm across both gloves, I can start shooting to the body, to the head, whatever I want. So I'm jabbing, I'm jabbing, I'm jabbing. I'm across both gloves. I can even yank body, head, over, under, whatever. And I am trying to take his face clean off. And his body clean off too. So another big thing with kickboxing is if you don't have hands, I think you'll have a hard time setting up a lot of your kicks. Because a lot of the best guys, they are very used to just kicks and they are very used to just hands. So let's move from a fake into some kicks, right? So let's go hand to leg. So we're gonna do a little half beat with a pump fake. I pump fake and I just bridge with that inside low kick. So again, I'm here and I bridge with that inside low kick. I'm nice and long, I'm keeping my balance, and I am not deviating from my stance all that much. So look, I'm here. Even if that right hand touches his glove, it's there as a trigger for the low kick. So this is lead hand, lead leg action. One more slow. Just like that, real simple. Don't lose your balance, and wherever your knee points is where the kick is gonna go. Real simple mechanics on your stuff. Now, what's cool is, especially if you're a longer, lankier person like me, sometimes you double trap, and then you hit the legs. So the guy's here, you push him off the double trap, and then you attack the leg. So I'm reaching right hand in front of the left. So my right hand is ahead of the left. As I trap his hands to hit that oblique stop, you would see this in JKD. You go position six, oblique stop, yank, elbow. You would see that in a basic trapping series. So it would be position six, oblique stomp, yank, elbow. I'm doing it without the elbow. So again, like I'm here, my right hand in front of my left. I'm cross pairing. I even keep my gloves on you on the kick. There's no time. And sometimes I shuffle and push and kick. So I'm here, I shuffle and push, and then I go front kick. Because you're here, you go like this, boom, that front kick. So again, I get my hands on you, I shuffle and push, way, big front kick right down the middle. Old school kickboxing stuff, that certainly works. Now, let's talk about how we're gonna change our boxing head movement so we don't get kneed in the face, or at least we can minimize it. We will never dip like this on a kickboxer or pin straight down. But if a hook comes and we roll it, and my chin is down, my guard is high, this is how I can minimize the risk. I go only as low as I need to, and I'm ready to fire. So let's say I was here, I roll as I'm coming up, I'm trying to take his head off. Like, you can't just sit there and throw boxing defense and look cute and think you're Floyd Mayweather, you will get smashed. Floyd Mayweather fights Buakaw, look it up. Buakaw murders Floyd Mayweather. Let me explain to you. Murders him, 99 out of 100. Too many tools, too much. I don't care how pretty your shoulder roll is. Viciousness and tools and putting it together is what works. And Buakaw is a great example of a guy that uses boxing with his elbows. He slips, bop, bop, and those elbows are coming from the Philly shell. So this is gonna be cool now, so pay attention. I'm here in the Philly shell. I catch, I parry, I dip with the slip, look. Sass, right underneath. Bang, bang, bang. So it's like under, and just putting it all together. If you can mix it up seamlessly, whether you're an MMA guy or just a JKD guy that loves street fighting and loves being able to defend himself or herself and their family, elbows are great tools. Elbows work great off the post. They're nasty. So again, off that Philly shell, I slip, I dip, bop. This thing just comes right up the middle. And what do you do after that? Bang, bang, you can come up with more shots. You can do all sorts of stuff, but you don't see this a lot. I saw Buakaw do it one time and I thought it was really cool, right? I was like, that's really cool. This is also good if you slip the wrong way. Imagine I'm right foot forward. He slips and I parry the right hand and I trap it. It's like, bop. So I slip the wrong way, but I parry the right hand because I'm going, oh my God, I'm going to get hit. I just touch his glove. Pop, pop. And these elbows are slicing like knives. And if you think elbows don't hurt or whatever, you're here. Yeah, like that's not friendly. It's nothing nice about them. They're basically cannons. Your knees and your elbows, when you're there, are just cannons. Like, you want to just destroy, seek and destroy whatever you're hitting. So, let's tie the JPP philosophy into both boxing and Muay Thai now. Well, let's say you come from a different background, Muay Thai, boxing, or whatever. Well, one of the things that some boxing gyms have, and even some Muay Thai practitioners have, is just simply being light on your feet. Good example of a guy that's bladed and light on his feet, arguably the best Muay Thai guy on the planet, Sanchez. Bladed, and he does all this, and you know, the cartwheel kicks, and all this kind of stuff. But look at his fundamentals. Pop, that funky. There's that guy that I really like, Mind Smash. Good YouTube channel. Talks about how Sanchez is really fancy, but man, those fundamentals. If you look at his rear leg front kick, his knee goes from point A to point B better than I've ever seen any kickboxer in the planet. And then he throws question mark kicks on top of it. What am I saying? The best blend things from different arts. He's throwing snap karate kicks in a Muay Thai fight. Meanwhile, the Muay Thai guys say that'll never work. But your best is using karate moves with a chamber question mark kick that isn't normally done in a typical Muay Thai class. And he's chambering a kick, not doing it Thai style, stepping through, I've done both, I know the difference. The stupid comments may come, but it's karate style. And anybody knows what they're looking at knows it's karate style. So now, let's say you have a specific tool. Let's say you like your kicks or you like your hands. You probably start with the other one first. Let's say I have great hands, I start with the legs, I end the combo with my hand. I save my best stuff for last normally. Or I go best, second best, last. Best, second best, best. You go second best, best, or best, second best, best. You never end on the worst part of your combo. You always end with the most powerful, the fastest, the most damaging part of the combo whenever you're in there. So we were talking about how a JKD person can, or how a Muay Thai or a boxer can use a JKD principle to get better. First one is just being in motion and establishing a rhythm and then consciously breaking that rhythm with a pattern of footwork. So I'll give you an example. I'm in a nice kind of boppy rhythm that you would normally see people shadow boxing in. And then I just pick it up a little bit and add little fakes, feints, make it a little bit herkier, jerkier. And that's a successful rhythm change. Same thing as hitting. One, two, three. One, two, three. Now, that rhythm has been set. One, two, body, three. So with one, two, pause for a second, body, three. Because sometimes his defense actually takes a half a second longer than you thought to come up, then the body comes, then the head comes right behind it. So, you know, we can go hours and hours and hours about the differences between boxing and Muay Thai and this and that, but it's really up to you, the practitioner, to be able to pull off the right move at the right time. Because if you have no hands, your kicks aren't going to land. But if you don't know how to deal with kicks at all, and you're just a boxer, let's see what Teddy was saying. Those leg kicks, those body kicks, those head kicks, you're going to start adding up. And I'll make the argument that the best boxer in the world fights the best Muay Thai guy in the world, or kickboxer in the world, in a kickboxing fight. Kickboxer wins every time. You're going to get some boxing punches, but oh, he's going to walk in, he's going to do this and that. It's probably not going to happen. Now, if you put a Muay Thai guy in a boxing ring, same thing happens, the boxer wins. Where they are is based on their game. Self-defense person, so many variables, weapons, multiple attacks, strength, outweight class, all these things, very, 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 very difficult. So, you know, I'll also just tell you another Jiu-Jitsu principle that I think any martial artist, including a boxer, kickboxer, JKD person, MMA person, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, wrestler needs to have. Changing of basic positioning. So let me explain. JKD day one, the lead hand is here, the shoulder's high, and you learn to pump this thing like no other for like your first year. Then you get a little bit cockier, and that thing comes in a little Philly shell like this. Then it comes down like this, then sometimes it pokes in the shell, sometimes it's reaching. That's just the hands. Sometimes my feet are very bladed. Sometimes I'm bouncing on the outside, and I'm just waiting to see what's going to happen. My feet change just a little bit. They might go wider, they might go smaller. I might just take these little micro movements at you, and I'm changing my rhythm with you. Then sometimes I just show off the head movement a little bit, but I'm taking angles. When I'm worried about power and their kicks, I'm taking these angles. Because remember, kickboxers are great in linear fashion. I'll say boxers are better at fighting off angles than kickboxers are. Kickboxers get in the center, they go, and then they get back in the center or on the ropes and they go. Boxers use the ring better. They have better ring generalship, whether they're chasing or running, whether they're the hammer or the nail, they have usually are good with where they are in the ring. So, you know, you're in there, let's say I move my head, now I take my feet with me, so I just make sure to get the hell out of there. Could I pivot into a kick? Yes. Could I pivot into a punch? Yes. But if I know where I am, I can slip and quarter and just completely change the trajectory of where I am. So my whole point is, if you don't have footwork, I'm gonna make this statement and some people aren't gonna like it, don't care. If you don't have footwork, you won't be able to land your punches. You're gonna get hit too. You won't be able to land your kicks and you will get kicked too. And I guarantee you'll get taken down by a strong wrestler too. The days of I just walk in and I have a right hand are done. The days of I just have one leg kick are done. These guys and gals are getting too good. They're too seasoned. They're learning the takedown defense. They're learning the offensive takedowns. And these guys are animals. They just are. You have to pick up your training if you want to take it to the next level. So, you know, I'm going to leave time for questions now. I hope you guys are enjoying it. You know, Cinco Teddy's super high level. He's a lifer like me. He's been doing martial arts since he was a kid. When we reopen, we're going to be doing some really cool stuff. A lot of distance training in the beginning, like covering distance with kicks, mirror drills, some mitts, you know, whatever the law says, obviously. But even if the law says that we can, we're probably going to avoid grappling for a bit. We're probably going to avoid trapping for a bit. We're probably going to avoid clinch sparring and clinch stuff for a bit. Even after the regulations say that we can, we will all be working on our outside fighting for a little while. And that's where it's going to go because that's the safest way to do it. And even if it's a low likelihood that you'll get sick, it's the best way to do it. So keep the questions, you know, ask away. I don't know if that's a question, Ted, but ask away, guys, because I'm going to answer them to the best of my ability. Just a comment. You're strong. Strong. There you go. So, yeah, I mean, listen, I don't want to offend anybody. And if I did, you know, too bad. I mean, your feelings are going to get hurt sometimes. But I'm just trying to give you guys a good synopsis of the pros and cons of each style and system. Even with Jeet Kune Do, I will tell you, yesterday I went through the pros and I went through the cons. I tried to be as unbiased as possible because you need to cover the holes in your game. And I even went deeper into Jeet Kune Do and said, well, even if you're good, here's some booby traps that if you're good, you can still lose or you can still get hit or things of that nature. So go back to yesterday, you'll see that. My whole point is martial artists we're a cool breed because, like, you know, we're problem solving live with something physical. So if you've come from a jiu-jitsu background or a Thai boxing background, you're able to problem solve in that context, you will be able to in a Jeet Kune Do context. It's really no different in some ways. Combat is combat. So yeah, guys, I mean, if you have no questions, we can close out. You know, I'm having a super fun time with you guys. I know Super Teddy is as well. And we're going to obviously keep doing these until we reopen. I'm going to probably do them even once a week when we're open, whether it's during class or not. We'll see what happens. But yeah, I mean, any questions that you guys want to have answered, I will. I'm telling you guys, we're dropping a really cool Bruce Lee video probably tomorrow or Friday. It's kind of like a little hype piece of some really cool guys talking about Bruce. So look out for that on Facebook, Instagram, and on YouTube. Share with your friends, family. I'd really appreciate it. But again, guys, if you guys have any questions, run a little early tonight. I had a great time with all y'all, and thank you so much. So thanks a million.